You know, there are 10,000 reasons, even more, 10,000 reasons to worship His name.
Amen, Lord.
Amen. Amen. And even during the other song also, let the worshipers arise. You know, I pray that you feel that deep inside you, something inside you just wants to cry out to your God. Yes. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
You know, I know there's something locked up inside each and every one of us. It is truly the life of God. And sometimes He's locked up far too long.
Amen.
And sometimes He's quiet way too often. Come on, are you out there? So I say, just give me a reason to worship our God. Amen?
Amen.
It's nice to come into the house. It's nice to come as a family and also have the opportunity to express what you know is inside.
Yes.
Praise God. Well, you know, it is good to see everybody in the house today. It's good to see those, of course, Felisa and Larry. It's been a while. It's good to see you back in the house.
Amen.
But everybody, Sharon back from vacation and, you know, the newcomers. God bless you all, man. God bless you all. You know, as Brother Nick was saying, and Brother Nick, I enjoy your words so much. You know, such words of life and power. I feel them to speak. You know, we are going through the book of Revelation on Wednesday nights. And we've gone through pretty well. I think we're getting down to the end of the book of Revelation. We have like four or five more chapters, which is going to work out well because we have, you know, really about four or five, six more Bible studies left before the end of the year. Mark your calendars. We got, you know, things for the end of the year. We have our New Year's Eve service and our Christmas Eve service. And always know this. We truly believe that God does speak to us and let us know what He wants to do with the earth before He does it. Do you know that? You know that God doesn't just want to surprise you. He wants to tell you what He's going to do first. You know, He wants to tell you. It's like it's so much goodness, like even God Himself. Think about God. He can't hold it. He wants to tell you the good stuff He's got planned for you. You ever do that? I don't know. Parents ever do that to your children? Like, you got something good for them, but sometimes you just can't keep it from them.
Yeah.
You say, hey, I can't tell you what we got, but we got something good coming, okay? You can count on it. So, you know, at the end of the year, God wants to say, hey, I got some good stuff for you guys. I got some good stuff. So, we're getting ready for our week of the gathering. We meet at the church for a week, 7 o'clock every night. That will be November 6th through November 9th. Because November 5th is our youth group. We will not cancel our youth group. And we prepare for what God has for the new year. But we've been in the book of Revelation. And last Wednesday, we spoke on a passage in Revelation chapter 17. So if you have your Bibles and if you'd like to turn there with me, why don't you turn to Revelation chapter 17? You know you don't have to have your Bibles because I will read to you. I think I'll turn there as well. Revelation chapter 17. We talked about this on Wednesday night. And Revelation chapter 17, it talks about the title in my Bible and yours as well, is The Woman on the Beast. The Woman on the Beast. And in this passage, it says that, let me start at the beginning. One of the seven angels who had the seven bowls came and said to me, come, I will show you the punishment of the great prostitute who sits on many waters. With her, the kings of the earth committed adultery, and the inhabitants of the earth were intoxicated with the wine of her adulteries. Then the angel carried me away in the spirit into a desert. Let me tell you something. After I read the first two verses, I thank God that the angel is going to carry me away in the spirit, because I need to know what that means, because it sounds like, you know, at first, I don't want to hear none of that. But we need understanding. And there I saw a woman sitting on a scarlet beast and was covered with the blasphemous names and had seven heads and 10 horns. Seven heads and 10 horns. Go down to verse 9. Here is the mind which has wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sits. There are also seven kings. We said this on Wednesday. Five are fallen, one is, and one has not yet come, and when he comes, he must continue a short time. Now you really gotta come on Wednesdays because there is true simplicity in these words. True simplicity. The passage here, it speaks about primarily all passages in the Bible speaks about God saving mankind. Revelation 17 is a picture of God saving your soul. You being the woman whom he loves, and he will do anything to come out and save you and heal you. Praise God. Now it says that this beast that had seven heads, it says those seven heads were seven kings. And we talked about those seven kings on Wednesday. And we said five were fallen. One is yet to come, and when he comes, he'll stay, for a while. You know, what we said on Wednesday was this, the five that are fallen, and you just, like you spoke about this last week, Esther, though. The five that are fallen are in regard to the five senses of man. We said this on Wednesday. We all know the five senses of man, right? We said on Wednesday, it is seeing, hearing, smelling, tasting, touching, five senses. And you see, God has created us in a new birth. Most of us, or some of us, hopefully most of us, if not all of us, would say we have been born again. Right? Anybody want to give me a better amen than that? Government trauma, right? Is that all right, Pastor? We in the right house today? Yeah, you're born again, right? All right, great, born again. So that means if we're born again, you must start to live a new life according to the new kingdom and the new world, right? The new world is my Father's world and your Father's world is the kingdom of heaven, where we no longer live according to the natural senses of man. You see, as an old man, we live according to what we see, according to what we hear, according to what we taste and touch. And that will sometimes rock our world, right? And the Lord comes into our lives and listen, those five kings, they must come to an end. I no longer want you to live by what you see and hear. I want you to live truly by the words of your Father. Live by what is invisible. And when you live by what is invisible, you will make what is invisible visible. You know that? A spoken word created everything. Right? Scripture says everything that is not seen is more real than everything that is seen. Everything that you see was created by the invisible realm, like a word of God. In the beginning, God said, let there be light. And there was light. And you all know the fascinating part of that? We know the sun wasn't created until 3 days later. So where did all the light come from? Spoken word. Amen. The invisible realm is so powerful. So powerful. And yet, so often and too often, we live by what we see, feel, touch. And the Lord says, no, those five kings are fallen. Then we talked about the other king here, because there were seven heads, which were seven kings. It says the one king, the sixth king, was the one who is. That's, once again, talking about natural man. Because remember, God created man on which day? The sixth day. The sixth day. Scripture says that six is the number of man. When we live just as a mere man, we are not living in all the glories of heaven as we should. Because you are not just mere men or mere women. You are more than that. Yeah. Yeah. That's why the seventh one has to come. And the seventh one, the seventh king that was going to come, we talked about him on Wednesday. The king that was coming, does anybody know the name of the king who is coming?
Jesus.
Yeah, it's fairly weak. It's fairly weak. Jesus is coming. I know. Yeah. All right. What's his name? His name is?
Jesus!
He is the king that is coming to save you. Great. Okay, we're getting there. And you and I have said all too many times, as we should, we have cried out in the darkest times of our life, sometimes in the joyous times of our life, and we've cried out for the name of
Jesus,
the seventh king. We said, hey, by the fallen, the one that's with me is useless, and I need another king.
Amen.
The king of kings. I need Jesus.
Yes.
I need King Jesus. Praise the Lord. A little bell on that for the Robin. That was perfect timing. Okay. So what I like about this passage, it says the king who is yet to come, listen, he's always here. But you know in your circumstances of life, you're waiting on sometimes, right? Like, where is my joy? He's coming. Where is my peace? He's coming. Where is my strength? Keep calling his name. Because he's coming. Where's my deliverance? Keep calling his name. What's his name?
Jesus.
Yeah, keep reminding him. His name is Jesus.
Yeah.
But what it says in Revelation is once he comes, it says, we said, he's only going to stay for a short while, according to the passage here. He's only going to stay for a short while. And you and I know that to be true. We have called upon Jesus in our time of need. Jesus has come and he saved us from sometimes the darkest of moments, the most painful of situations. Anybody. He has come and he saved us, but then you and I both know he only stayed a short while because next week I was in trouble again. Yeah. He only stayed a short while. And as we muse on Wednesday, sometimes he stays for a week, sometimes a day. Sometimes, like, yeah, I don't know. Seems like he only stays for a few minutes and he's gone. Something that makes you laugh and all of a sudden you hate the world again. I don't know. And the king who is coming, who will come and only stay for a while, you see, he keeps leaving. That's why we got calling him. Jesus, where'd you go? Jesus says, I don't go anywhere. Where'd you go? Never leave us. I want you to see, this story in Revelation is not a scary story. It's only scary when we read it through our senses, okay? Yeah. When we read it, as Scripture says, through the Spirit, we have salvation.
Amen.
The seventh king is King Jesus. He will come, but you know sometimes he only stays a while. Because, we keep calling for him and calling for him. And as we talked on Wednesday, we are not waiting for the second coming of the Lord. Scripture never even says once about the second coming of the Lord. Jesus Christ is the ever coming one. Jesus Christ will come into your life every time you need him.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
If Jesus Christ only came in my life twice, only in your life twice, you are a rotten, lost mess. Twice. You need a thousand of times a day. The ever coming. What we saw in this book of Revelation, that this beast still had to be destroyed, even though Christ as king was part of that beast, had to be destroyed because, listen, Christ cannot just be one of the kings of your life. Like one day King Jesus rules and one day your emotions rules. One day King Jesus rules, so one day your circumstances rule, right? One day Jesus rules, one day depression rules. One day Jesus rules, one day weakness rules. Are you tired of me talking? Shut up, stop talking about me. See, this beast has to be destroyed because Jesus doesn't want to be one of your kings. He wants to be the king.
Amen.
He's just not part of your life. He is your life.
Yes.
Come on.
Yes.
God is going to take us to a place where Jesus Christ is not just part of our life. He is the reason why we wake up every morning. He's the reason why we breathe. He's the reason.
Amen.
Uh-huh. And that's why later on in the book we read that the one who is coming, who is entitled King of Kings. Not one of many. No, King of Kings. And
Lord of
Lords. Amen. Now, in regard to the seventh man, why don't you turn to another passage that Pastor Phil referred to last week, and as he spoke, this struck me. The book of John. The Gospel of John. Chapter 4. Verses 15 through 18, if you'd like to read along. Yeah. And this is the story about Jesus Christ and the woman at the well. Most of us know the story, the woman at the well. Let me pick up somewhere in the middle, verse 15. It says, "The woman said to him," Jesus, "Sir, give me this water, so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." Jesus told her, Go call your husband and come back. The woman replied, "I have no husband." She replied, and Jesus said to her, "You are right when you say you have no husband. The fact is you have had five husbands. And the man who you now have is not your husband. What you have just said is quite true." And as we have shared before, most of us know the story? Huh. And as we relate it to the book of Revelation, the seventh man was right in front of this woman. The seventh man, you remember his name?
Jesus.
the seventh man is to come, Jesus. Jesus. This woman was waiting for truly the Savior of her soul, the lover of her soul, the husband of all eternity, Jesus. And Jesus says, it's true, the one who you're with is not yours, because Jesus says, I'm yours.
Amen.
I'm yours. I am always so moved by that passage that Jesus will move heaven and earth. He'll go to hell and heaven to get you. He loves you. You are his bride. You are his most precious chosen of all creation. And he's a jealous God in the fact that he says, when you say you've had five and the one you're with is not yours, Jesus says with a godly jealousy, he said, you better believe that one's not yours.
Amen.
He says, you're mine. You're mine. You're mine. Uh-huh. I'll take you too. And Jesus said, I came to see you today. I came to see you today. Because remember, when Jesus walked the earth, all of Jerusalem was looking for him. They wanted to hear his teachings. Jesus said that one day, that one time, he said, I must have need to go to Samaria. Jesus, they said to Jesus, where are you going? You're going the long way. Where are you going? You're going to Samaria. He said, we didn't even go to Samaria. Jesus said this, I just want to see one woman today. I want to see one woman. That's how precious you are. That God will leave the 99. He'll leave the world to come and get you. And it's always at the right time, huh?
Yes.
This woman says, I've been through six and I'm worn out. Jesus says, good. Then we're all right on time. Jesus says, you have a need and I have a need. You know God has a need? Yep, yes, it's for prayer. So the seventh man that we were waiting for, that she was waiting for, was right before him. Always remember, this woman is a picture of all mankind. This woman is a picture of the soul of man. Remember, the soul cannot live alone. The soul was never intended to live alone. The soul was always intended to have expression and or to be an expression of God Almighty. Yeah. You have a soul to express who God is. And all too often, the soul experiences an earth realm and starts to live and breathe out of it. And most of the five fallen kings, your senses were not meant to be lived by. Your senses were meant to express who the invisible God is. Amen?
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. So Jesus is the seventh man who, he wants to come into your life. He's looking for you. He's looking for you. Is anybody looking for him?
Yes.
Good answer. I'm looking for him. I need him. I want him. But Jesus wants you just as much. He does. And you know, even when you look back to the beginning of creation, you look back to the beginning of creation, when God first created man. Always remember, these are pictures. They're pictures. Do you remember when man was created, and man didn't say this, God said this. God said, it is not good for man to be
alone.
Right? And that's when God put Adam to sleep, and he pulled from his side the woman. Right? And the two were supposed to be one. And God then told them, he said, now you go and take dominion. He told them, take dominion, man and the woman. But that is a picture of, man and woman is always a picture of God and man, picture of the spirit man and the soul man, picture of God and man, God and man, God and man. The scripture says this, it's not good for God to be alone. God doesn't want to be alone. Come on. Why do you think you were created? Yeah. It was a picture of God himself. He says, I want some company. I want a relationship. I want intimacy. I want compassion and love. And that's why God was saying, it's not good for me to be alone. I want you. And that's why you see the same picture on the cross of Calvary, the same picture on the cross. When Jesus Christ hung upon a cross, he was put to sleep, and then out of his side came forth the water and the blood. And come again, the picture of the birth of the church, his bride. You see, God, listen. God does not want to be alone. He wants to be with you. Now let me tell you something about the seventh man. The seventh man does not want to rule over you. Although he is the King of Kings and he rules all of creation, the intent of God is not to rule over you. This is his intent. To rule with you.
Amen.
He wants to rule with you. Of course God rules all things. Of course, whatever he says goes, right? See, the thing about power and authority is this. God doesn't want to do it by himself. You ever been in a position, I don't know, whatever the position might be, maybe a position of leadership or a position of exclusivity, and you know, you just don't want to be in that position alone. Hopefully you're in service. Yes. It's like, I don't really like to do this with somebody. It's easier. It makes it fun. You ever notice when you do something by yourself, it's more about getting the job done than really enjoying anything? And the Lord says, I just want to enjoy this. He doesn't want to rule over you. Listen, he is the king. He will rule over you. He will rule over you. When you are in a state where you need to be ruled over, when you are in a state where you need peace, he's going to come into your life and he's going to be the Prince of Peace. So it's okay. It's good stuff. When you need joy, he's going to come and rule in your life and he's going to give you joy. But he wants to get you to a place where you have peace and you have joy and your soul is secure. And he says, why don't you and I just rule together? See, the Lord Jesus Christ, he wants to rule on this earth through you. Where you and I no longer live this life in a position as a victim or in a position as defeated or in a position any less than what God has created you to be. When God created the woman, he created an equal so that they could rule together. It's a picture of you and God. Amen?
Amen.
Take a look here in Revelation, the 21st chapter of Revelation. And I'd like to read the first five verses. Most of you know these passages, and let these words be words of great comfort to all. Revelation 21, verse 1 says this. Then I saw, you guys know this, a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God. What does it say there? Prepared as a
bride.
Beautifully dressed for her husband, the seventh man. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, now the dwelling of God is with men. And I will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. Verse 4. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain. For the old order of things has passed away. He who was seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. Then he said, write down this thing, for these words are trustworthy and true. Revelation 22, we've got to go down a little bit, verses 5 through 6. There will be no more night. They will not need the light of a lamp or the light of the sun, for the Lord God will give them light. And they will reign forever and ever. The angel said to me, once again, these words are trustworthy and these words are trustworthy and true. It's the same words that the woman at the well said when she spoke to Jesus. She said to Jesus, these words that you speak are true. I do look for you. I do long for you. These words are trustworthy and true. The angel said to me, these words are trustworthy and true. The Lord, the God of the spirits of the prophets, sent his angel to show his servants these things that must soon take place. Praise the Lord. This picture that we see in the book of Revelation is a life that Jesus Christ wants to live with you here and now.
Amen. Yeah.
Praise the Lord. And I cannot help, when I read passages like this, I cannot but help to think of all those who have gone before us, you know? And even all those who have gone before us, you know, they still look to live a life. They still need a body of expression. I do believe that all those who have gone before us, they still live a life through us.
Amen.
Yeah? Got a lot of amens on that. That's good. Yeah. Because Scripture says that that they are not perfected without us. Like, although God, and listen, God chooses the time. He chose those who go before us, but they still will live through us. They're still going to live a life through us. Let me say this. We are not all dying to go somewhere. Okay? Everybody who has left this place is waiting to come back here. Okay? I don't know if you're all with me on that one. Remember, Jesus Christ, he's bringing his kingdom on earth. You guys ever read the end of the book?
Yeah,
he comes with a great army, and he establishes his kingdom right here on earth. So where are you going to rule and reign, everybody? Right here on earth. When does that start? Yeah, you know it started a long time ago. It starts whenever you have an encounter with the seventh man. The seventh man. You and I walk through this life having all kinds of kings and husbands and lovers who say their mothers control our lives and, I'm sorry, torment our lives. And you can apply that any way you want. Because we all look for love. We all look for peace. We all look for a life that can truly be lived. And all too often, we're willing to let go of this life because we can't find what we're looking for. Because I can't find the seventh man, I say this life then has no value to me. I'm looking for something more. Someone tell me I'm not alone. Great. You are looking for the seventh man. God will give you all kinds of pleasures in this life, but let me tell you, your true husband, I don't care if you're man or woman, your true husband is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Listen, he is the one who is married to you. He is the one who has died for you. He is the lover of your soul. He is the one who will walk through hell and fire, go through the depths of the sea, the highest of heavens to come and get you. He is the only one who can see you in your darkest moment, in a time when you think you feel the dirtiest that you've ever been. He is the only one, the true lover of your soul, who will come up into your life and says, there you are, I've been looking for you. Not anymore. And he'll look into your face and your eyes and say, he'll say how beautiful you are and how fair you are. He says to you, and he says, I'm the seventh man, I'm the one you're looking for. And he didn't come into your life to rule over you. You hear me? Got one amen. He didn't come into your life to rule over you. He's your husband. Listen. He wants to rule with you. He wants to rule with you. We just had a marriage not too long ago. Amen? We enjoy life together. He wants to rule with you. He is so rich. He is so powerful. He is so strong. Why should his wife be weak? Why should his wife be poor? Why should his wife have anything less than what he has? So if you need a savior, he'll save you. He'll say, listen. Everything I have is yours. He says, come and rule and reign with me in this life. I know that Jesus Christ is the seventh man that you and I are all looking for. He's going to come into your life, and he wants to rule and reign, come on, in this life with you. He doesn't want you to be under anything. He says, listen, hear the words as if they were just spoken this morning. They were spoken 7,000 years ago. He says, take dominion. You hear the voice of God?
Amen.
He says, take dominion. Does anybody feel like taking dominion? You don't have to raise your hand. He says, take dominion. He says, rule and reign in this life. Come on now. Just the words of God. You just hearing those words of God will cause it to happen in your life. He says, you're subject to nothing. You have and own everything. He says, I want you to rule and reign in this life with me. And let me tell you a little something. Let me tell you a little something. All those who have gone before us that did not obtain the promises that we wanted them to obtain, they can still obtain them through you. Amen. They will still live and reign through you. They will gain victory over things they never gained victory over through you. Amen. That causes me, and I hope it causes you, to rise up. Yes. It says, I will get the victory for them. I will be strong for them. I will conquer these things for them, by the grace and the power of God. Can you say the same thing? I got some of you. Come on now. It ain't over yet. It ain't over yet. You're still sitting. You're still breathing. Sometimes you're smiling. Sometimes you're not. But it ain't over yet. The seventh man is yours. He's going to marry you, he's going to love you, he's going to save you, and he's going to say, come on, let's rule and reign together. Can I get a witness? Amen. I'm so excited. Come on, praise you. Hallelujah. Listen, church, it ain't over yet. It ain't over yet. And let me say this also, everyone has loved ones who have passed before us. For those who have gone before us, it still ain't over yet. Do you know that? Yeah. Does anybody know that? Yeah. Scripture says they're not perfected without us. Even though they're not here, it ain't over yet. They will still get victory. They will still get crowns. They will still get glory because they're getting through us. Yeah. That empowers me. Empowers you. Yeah. I don't know.